Okay, that's good. The Lord has healed our machine. I'm in Zimbabwe right now in a small town called Kwekwe, and it's been raining very hard. And so the internet connection sometimes gets cut off because of the rain. But it's a real pleasure to be here. And thank you, Brother Jeff, for coordinating this this training, this workshop. And thank you to all the leaders that are present and listening in. And we trust that this is going to be a blessing and also be kind of steps ahead for what the Lord has for you as a church and as individuals in your walk into missions. I just wanted to introduce ourselves just a little bit. My name is Roland, and my wife is Christina Grenier. I'm a Canadian, and my wife is from Colombia. And the Lord gave us three children, and we now have five grandchildren. And we, at this time, we're based out of Ghana, where we have our ministry base. We've been serving with WEC International since 1992. First, we were serving in Spain with the Batel ministry, working on the streets with drug addicts. And then the Lord changed our direction to move into the continent of Africa in 1993, where we served for 20 years in Equatorial Guinea. My wife and I, we went to work with the national church to help in the areas of church planting, especially amongst unreached groups. But we saw the need for training, as Paul has just emphasized now, the need for well-trained, qualified pastors and also missionaries to go out. And so my wife and I, we started two Bible schools on the mainland and also on the island for training pastors and leaders interdenominationally with a mission focus in their training. So we had the privilege of serving there for 20 years, and we're very excited to see that now the Bible school is continuing on completely in the hand of national workers that are there. As you've heard before, WEC International is an international mission. It has about 100,900 workers worldwide and from 90 different countries approximately, in 90 different countries, and also from about 70 different nationalities. I was calculating with my wife last night and thinking of how many countries in Africa do we have missionaries from? And we looked and calculated that we think that there's 11 or 12 different countries in Africa that we have nationalities of Africans within WEC International. And we believe that that's going to be continuing to grow in these coming years. Because like Paul mentioned, we believe that this is the time for Africa. We believe that the Lord has planned that in this final wave of world missions that the church in Africa is going to play a major part. When we were first brought into to work with WEC, we were brought in, especially through the motto of WEC, which some of you have heard before. C.T. Studd said, if Jesus Christ be God and died for me, that there's no sacrifice too great for me to make for him. And we're grateful here on the continent of Africa that many people have made that sacrifice so that we could have the gospel in our hands, and that the church has been planted in every country here on the continent. And we're trusting that also that the African church will be continuing to take up that torch along with the rest of the mission world to be able to see the finalizing of bringing the gospel to every unreached people group in the world. And so we've been called to work with the ministry within Acts 13, and it's the door for Africans within sub-Sahara Africa to be able to enter into WEC and also to be able to be in partnership so that we can see unreached people groups on the continent and also beyond to be able to be reached for Christ. Again, just in repetition from Paul, I don't have to get into a lot of detail. Paul presented a very good presentation of the needs within the world. But we believe that right now the next wave of missionaries that are be sending out are coming from those three areas of Africa, Asia, and also Latin America. And we see as we travel around, we see more and more in every country we travel in Africa, we see an awakening, a desire to get involved in world missions. And so we're encouraged and also challenged with the work that is ahead. It was interesting, yesterday in our service, I was asked to speak in a small Baptist church here in Kwekwe. And during the service, there was a couple from Botswana that came into our service, and they were on their way to go to Mozambique to work with the Makwe people, an unreached Muslim group. And the church here in Kwekwe had been praying for this a young couple. They have only been married for a year and a half, and they now have a small child of 6 months. And the Lord had called them from their farming town in Botswana to go to Mozambique, and they had just passed. It wasn't a coincidence, but they passed through, and they were with us and be able to share their vision and ask for more prayer. And as a local small church, they got on their knees before the congregation. And the congregation prayed for them and sent them off again to be able to commit themselves to be praying for them as they go to work with the Makwe people. So God is on the move, I believe, in almost every nation here on the continent. And we're excited, and we believe it's a privilege to be part of what God is doing here. 2010 meetings of Lausanne in Cape Town. And we believe that during that meeting, the leaders of churches around the world and mission leaders in consensus that they believe that the African church bringing the gospel to the last and to the least and to the lost. So as a mission, we began to pray and see on board. I hear a lot of themselves. As we began our steps ahead, I'm just going to read, it says, forget the former thing, new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? These past 30 years that we've had the privilege of serving here on the continent of Africa, we see very clearly that Africa is no longer just a mission field, but it has the potential of being a mighty mission force. Although that we still have a lot of work to do, we still have over 900 unreached people groups here on the continent. And we still have work to do around the world with approximately 7,000 unreached people groups that still do not have a solid church amongst them around the world. But we see that the church in Africa is being shaken, and it's being moved to be a part. As we travel around to different countries, it's very exciting to be able to see that wherever we go, pastors and leaders are coming to us and say that we believe that God would have us be a part of sending out workers as well. As Paul mentioned as well, that there's a lot of need for training. He said that 70% of workers that are being sent out, not just from Africa, but from around the world, without good training and good support from their churches, they're returning home and not able to continue with the call that God has put on their lives. This is the time no longer just for the African church to be receiving from outside, but also giving. We know that the church in Africa has the resources to be sending out workers. We have the personnel resources to send out. They have that passion and desire to go out. We're equipped in many, many ways To be able to go, and also the financial resources. The church in Africa can no longer say that we don't have what it takes to be involved in God's plans as we travel around, being from Canada and also from Colombia as a couple. Sometimes we get the message from certain that they still believe that that global missions is still the job of the Mozungu, to be going out, to be see that as we travel around, some of the, even the smaller churches are becoming very active in sending workers cross-culturally. I'm going to be giving a few church in Botswana, having sent this young couple now often to work with the Makwe people. They're going out and are being well supported by their church. And they have, the church in Africa has the resources if we can be able to focus them properly. I'm going to be having a couple times of kind of questions and comments. We know very clearly that we do not have all the answers. And that's one of the reasons why we desire to work and partner with the churches in Africa. Because in every country we go to, there's different giftings that God has given, and also different experience and understanding that also helps us to become more effective. So at any time, anybody would like to have a question, or you would like to have a comment or something to add, please feel free and to be able to just speak up and contribute where you feel you where you feel you can. So you can stop me at any time. But what we do know is that the church in Africa is the fastest growing church, and it's the largest church, evangelical church, in the entire world. On the continent of Africa, there are over 600 million plus evangelical Christians on the continent, and it's growing fast every day. We see mega churches and also house churches popping up wherever we go. Many missiologists, and we heard this very clearly at the Lausanne conference, many missiologists believe that the church in Africa will play a very key and important role in finishing the task of the Great Commission. Someone once asked me, why are there still so many unreached people groups? Why are there so many of these tribes and nations that still have never heard? And the only answer that I have for them, they're the last, because they're the hardest ones to reach. They're the hardest spiritually, and with the hardest hearts. They're in some of the most difficult areas to be able to reach, even physically difficult to reach, but also politically very difficult to reach, and also religiously to be able to even get into some of these countries. And we see that the church in Africa, Africans have a special quality, a special ability to be able to get into places and to be able to stay into places where others haven't been able to do in the past. At this time, I believe there's Africans in every country in the entire world. And often where they go, they start churches wherever they go as well. I want to give you an example of two indigenous missions that are growing very quickly here on the continent of Africa. Just to give you a bit of a picture, you may know of both of these already. Capro Mission. It was actually a mission that came to WEC back in the 70s. And they desired to join WEC and to become part of us, to be able to be sent out into some of the unreached areas around the world. And at that time, back in the 70s, our mission WEC wasn't prepared to be able to receive the number of workers that they were talking about coming in from Nigeria. And we couldn't really see it at that time, how that we were going to be receiving Nigerians into WEC, which was at that time mainly a Western mission. But they came in and they did training with us. And CAPRO, or Calvary Ministries, now is the largest evangelical mission sending agency, I believe, on the continent of Africa. they have over that are serving globally, reaching unreached people groups. They have a real clear vision and passion to be able to bring the gospel where there is no church at all. I was speaking the other day with the international director, Reverend Dondo from Nigeria. And he said very clearly to me, as we go around and talk to churches, he says, we need more indigenous mission partners in all the countries for sustainable enlargement towards church planting amongst 56 tribes that they've identified. And this is the contact information for Dr. Francis Kishimawa that is stationed actually in Kenya, and his email address as well. And they're involved also in local training of workers that are being sent out. So he said that he would be very open to be able to hear from you as well, to be able to work along with the local denominations, to be able to help in sending out of workers, both nationally and also throughout the continent. There's also another mission that we have a partnership with, and it's called Fulani Ministries. The Fulani people are the largest nomadic unreached people group in all of Sub-Saharan Africa. They are spread out throughout many countries in the Sahel region. And up until very recently, they were seen as one of the most difficult tribes, ethnic groups to be able to reach with the gospel. Our mission from the time that we entered into the region back in the 30s and 40s have made much effort and a lot of investment of many workers that have come to be able to reach the Fulani people with the gospel, with very, very little fruit in the first decades. But we've seen in these last years, we believe due to a lot of the planting and discipleship that has been done throughout these years, we've seen a new awakening amongst the Fulani people. These pictures that I have here are actually in Burkina Faso. And the bottom right picture, in the middle, there's a man with the red checkered shirt on. His name is Borema Diallo. And he was a Muslim from Burkina Faso. He was a Fulani. He got saved just through the testimony of a local Christian worker as a small child. And then as he grew, he ended up getting involved in a Christian group at university. And then the Lord put upon his heart to be able to reach out to his own people. And now he's has a ministry in Burkina Faso in a village setting. And he brings training to Fulani workers who are mostly nomadic, walking around with their cows and with their goats. And he trains them to be able to go out small house churches wherever they go. Now we're seeing Fulanis coming to the Lord in almost all of the Sahel countries and establishing churches. The ministry of Fulani Ministries, they have planted hundreds of house churches as they have traveled around. And it's a very effective ministry. And they're always looking for partners as well to be able to join them in areas of teaching and also training, and to be able to come up with ways that they can be more sustainable amongst their workers. These are just two indigenous ministries that we have partnerships with, and we work together. They bring training to us, and we also bring workers to them to be able to help in the work that they're doing. I could go on and on of many others that we are starting to partnership with, but also as we travel around, indigenous mission groups are sprouting up throughout the continent. And we know that in Kenya, it's no exception. Kenya is one of the leading countries in indigenous mission groups that are starting to take leading roles at reaching their own people, but also sending out workers across borders as well. So we're very excited about what God is doing on the continent. And we are very eager to be able to partner with these indigenous groups that are springing up in different areas. Like I said before, God is truly on the move in Africa. But we also see that there's, as we see many of these mega churches raised up in DRC, in Nairobi, large churches established, we're starting to see a lot of house churches established, especially amongst some of these smaller groups, like the smaller groups in different countries. But there's still over 900 unreached people groups just on the continent of Africa alone. And we see the needs more and more. Brother Paul presented some of the global needs that are around. One thing that struck me, right, as we look at the Church of Antioch that sent out workers, Paul and Barnabas, back in the 13th chapter of the book of Acts, it really struck me when this earthquake hit on the border of Turkey and Syria, because that was actually right in the area where the first missionary church in the book of Acts sent out their first workers. But now in that area alone, about 99% of the population in that area would be Muslims. There's only 0.01% of the population in that area which would be considered evangelical Christians. And if we see at this time that there was about 45,000 people, and those numbers are growing, of people that were killed during that earthquake, we would see that there would be less than 50 people that were killed in that earthquake that are today with our Lord Jesus Christ, that they went to heaven, and that there was 44,950 people that have been declared that they've died during that time, that have gone on to an eternity without Christ. And so we could talk about these same type of situations around the world with global catastrophes and pandemics that are happening. And we see the need for us to be able to wake up and to get engaged and to be well-trained, and as local churches to be sending out our workers to be able to complete the job. I'm going to stop there for a moment. And just before I go on to talk about Acts 13, I want to see if there's any questions or any things you would like to add at this time. Are you hearing me, Jeff?
I think, Roland, it's better to have that question sometime at the end of the session, right?
Okay, that's good. That's good. I just didn't want to go ahead too quickly. Thank you. Are you still hearing me okay, Jeff?
Yes. Yep.
Okay. So Brother Jeff has asked if I would be able to give a brief presentation of Acts 13, the ministry within WEC. We are the membership department, or the door that opens up for people that feel God calling them in to work with WEC, but also to be sent out to specific unreached people groups around the world. And so I'm going to give you just a bit of a kind of a background of where we came from and why we're doing what we're doing. Back in 2012, we as a mission within the Africa area, we were really challenged still the daunting task that was laid before us. And with the few workers we were hearing reports from churches throughout Africa taking amazing steps of obedience in sending out workers. And also in many of the countries where we had church planting teams, we saw it was more of an interest of African workers wanting to join our teams wherever we were established. And so we, at that conference, felt the Holy Spirit speaking to us. And we affirmed our commitment to our three objectives within WEC, which are evangelism, rest, and we were convinced that the Lord would fulfill these three churches and other like-minded mission organizations as well. And so at that time, we decided to initiate a membership department or a region base to be able to reach out to from the local churches into WEC. So it was in 2016 that God confirmed this ministry, and we adopted why we chose the name of Acts 13. The book of Acts is a fulfillment of the words of Zechariah 4:7, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord Almighty. And we believe that the church in Africa today can identify with the book of Acts, that it's not by might nor by power or by riches, but by the empowerment of the Holy Spirit. And as we travel around, we see that so much a reality. Of the global church, a church that is one, a church that is praying, and they want to be able to respond to what God is saying to us. We see as the church is growing here on the continent in ways that the Western church would never have believed in the past. We believe that it's a Holy Spirit movement happening in the on the continent, and it's spreading quickly around. So we believe that the church in Africa can identify clearly with the book of Acts as well. Acts 13, verses 1 to 3 is kind of our using as an example for us as how we establish and as we partner with African churches. The emphasis of Acts 13 is a model for the church in Africa as they experience the Holy Spirit speaking to leaders of a multicultural leadership team, which includes two African brothers, both Lucius and also Simeon, were both Africans that were part of the first missionary church that sent out Paul and Barnabas out. As we were in the service yesterday, and as the brothers and sisters were praying for this Botswana couple being sent off to the Makwe people in Mozambique, it struck me, and it as I was reading through this passage, there was three of the leaders that had their hands on Paul and Barnabas as they were being sent out to go up into Asia to bring the gospel. And out of those three leaders, two of those leaders were Africans that were that had their hands laid on Paul and Barnabas that were sending them out, both Lucius and also Simeon. And just I guess, confirmation in my heart that as God has been using African workers from the beginning of the church, we believe that the Lord is also going to be using the African church to send out workers to be able to finish the task as well. They, as a church, in obedience, in faith, laid their hands on them and they sent them off. And so we feel very strongly the need to focus on the local church that partnering with local churches in the sending out of their workers is essential to be able to be effective and sustainable, to be able to see workers being sent and also to be able to be maintained on the fields. The acronym that we have for Acts 13, we see our ministry is being African. And at this time, my wife and I, we were the spearheaders of the mission, but very quickly, most of our teams around are mainly African workers that are leading the different teams in the east, in the west, and other southern region of the continent. And we're very excited, and we believe that the Lord would have the Acts 13 ministry being using a contextualized approach to be able to be most effective at training and also preparing workers to be sent out. Cross-cultural, the C, is to emphasize the cross-cultural aspect of the ministry. and not just denominational expansion. One of the things that I think that is a real challenge and a struggle as national churches, denominations are sending out their kind of extension of their denomination, planting churches maybe in villages or communities or in areas where there isn't a church from their own denomination. But we've seen just the need for national churches to be able to look more cross-culturally and how we can bring the gospel in a way that is going to be much more contextualized in the areas where we're going to be sending. So that's much more of our emphasis. Training, we provide a wide variety of training, mobilization, helping churches become missional, candidate orientation for people who are joining our mission, and other specialized courses such as Islam, businesses, missions, etc. And then in the sending, our main heart and passion and the end of what we are doing is to be able to see national churches sending out their workers to the least reached people around the world. Our mission statement is partnering with the church in Africa and sending cross-cultural workers to make and beyond. With this, as a mission, we've identified 30 unreached people groups on the continent where we're specifically focusing on recruiting 30 unreached people groups. And if you'd like more information about these groups, we could send them to you as well. Our main objectives is that we will be flexible and mobile in order to respond to God's leading and serving and partnering with the church in Africa in all of sub-Saharan countries.